Everyone today, beautiful day out. Beautiful. Every day is a beautiful day. I'm just glad to be here. We're going to open up with hymn number 432, I'll Fly Away. Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shores. Scripture by Deacon Cornigan.
Dear gracious and loving Father, we are just so grateful, Lord, that you're here for us. We thank you, Lord, that the church doors were not padlocked shut. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, that you allowed our eyes to open this morning, that we were able to get out of bed. We were able to dress ourselves, wash up, oh God, and we're able to be here again. And we thank you, Lord. We don't take it for granted. There's so many people who couldn't do any of those things this morning for themselves, or they couldn't do anything at all. But Lord, you thought it not robbery. You thought it should be that we would be out here today. And so, Father, we're here to give you glory and honor. We're here to serve you and worship you, O God. We're here, Heavenly Father, to give you praise for the things you've done from last Sunday until this very moment. And Heavenly Father, we praise you for our church family, for each individual here, whether it be a visitor or somebody who's been here for a good while. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for our pastor and the other ministers, oh God. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the leaders and the followers in this church family. We thank you, Lord, for the musicians. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for each role that different people play here today. We thank you, dear gracious Father, and we pray that you would help us to continue to worship you and to serve you as we know how and as you would want us to. And then, merciful Father, when it's time for us to move outside these four walls, we pray, Lord, that we would serve you as you would have us to, that we would give you the glory and honor, that we would uplift and encourage people to say your name and then to believe your word and then, Heavenly Father, to receive you as Lord and Savior of their lives. Lord, we just are so grateful, and we offer this prayer in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you, Lord.
Amen. 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 Praise God. Now, if you open your hymn books with me to hymn number 10, Oh, How I Love Jesus. There is a name I love to hear, love to sing his word. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. scripture is coming from Psalms 113, 1 through 9. And it reads, "Praise ye the Lord. Praise, O ye servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun unto the going down thereof the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like unto the Lord our God, dwelleth on high, who humbled himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in earth. He raised up the poor out of the dust, and like the needy, and lifted the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his people. He maketh the barren woman to keep house and to be a joyful mother of children." The Lord's words are already blessed. Thank you. Thank you. We thank you for participating with us in this devotional service. At this time, we're going to turn it over to the hands of the pulpit. Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, church. This is the day that the Lord has made. I'm rejoicing and I'm glad in it, and I pray that you too are rejoicing and glad in it. God is a good God. He's blessed us, he's kept us, he's watched over us. Let us stand for our invocation. Our responsive reading is coming from the 100th Psalm. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands.
Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing.
Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Let us recite our mission and vision statement together. To introduce, present to all people Jesus Christ through our empowering ministries, by equipping the membership through the effective teaching and preaching of the word to the glory of God. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today to lift up the name of Jesus. We thank you, dear God, for how you've blessed us, kept us, watched over us. Not only us, Lord God, but our families. We're grateful, dear God. We thank you for all that you have done for us. We ask, dear God, that your spirit would take charge of this service today. We pray, Lord, that you just bless our pastor, that he would be able to bring forth the word in power. We pray, Lord, that you would open the eyes and spirit of understanding to those who hear the word today, that they might be edified, that they might be blessed. We pray, Lord God, if there are any who are unsaved, that this day they would confess Jesus as their Lord and Savior. Have your way, dear God, in this service. Have your way, dear God, in our lives. We offer this prayer in Jesus' name. We give you all praise, glory, and honor. Amen and amen. A member of our choir will come forth to lead us in this morning's congregational hymn.
Give me that old, excuse me, give me that old time religion. It's in the book, but we don't sing it like that.
We'll now have our scripture reading.
Good morning, church. Sermon text will be coming from the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. The book of Acts, chapter 3, first 6 verses. I will be reading the New American Standard Version, and it reads, "Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the ninth hour, the hour of prayer. And a man who had been lame from his mother's womb was being carried along, whom they used to set down every day at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, in order to beg alms of those who were entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he began to ask to receive alms. But Peter, along with John, fixed his gaze on him and said, 'Look at us.' And he began to give them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, 'I do not possess silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk.'" Amen.
Next time you're riding down the road in your car, sing this to the Lord. You'll get where you're going much faster. Come. Let us.
Come, let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Kneel down before him.
Worship and adore him.
Worship and adore him.
Come on, say it again.
Lord!
gracious and loving God, Father, we thank you and bless you for the privilege that is ours to be in this space on this day. We honor you, Lord, for your greatness and for your loving kindness that you extend to each and every one of us. We pause this morning just to acknowledge you as our God and our King. We ask, Lord God, that you would have your way. That you would have your way this day, that all that we say and do will give glory, honor, and praise to your holy and righteous name. We thank you, God, for what has already taken place and what will continue to take place as we give you glory and honor. Lord, whatever you have to do to me to get your word through me, do it even now in the name of Jesus. Not though that I, but you, O God, might get all of the glory, all in the honor. It's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. And all the people of God said, amen. Amen. Good morning, family. What a blessing it is to be in this space on this day. We greet all of you who are here in the sanctuary and those who are joining us on live stream. We greet you this morning in the only name that matters, and that is the name of Jesus, who is our Lord and our Christ. Amen? Amen. I don't know about you. It has been a trying and emotional week for me, but the God that we serve is able to give us the strength, the power, and the encouragement we need, amen, to deal with all of those emotional and trying situations that come our way. Don't want to be long this morning. I know many of our members have gone over to the United Methodist Church that we might bid farewell to one of our good friends, Pastor Wendy Modesto, who this is her last Sunday. She will be leaving our area, and they're having a farewell service and reception for her today. And as soon as we finish the benediction here, we will be going over to join with her as well. It is a season of transition. Season of transition. I know I've given these announcements already to Minister Smith, but we also learned this week that Pastor Allen has also been transferred, the pastor of Bethel AME. So I understand that there is a new pastor there that started on last Sunday, have not had the opportunity to meet him or her at this point, but we are praying for both congregations that God will provide leadership in this time of transition. Amen. But not only is it transition in the time of our community, but it's also a time of transition in the biblical text as we deal with the church and its transition after the day of Pentecost and the emergence of this newfound faith called Christianity. I want to invite your attention back to the Acts of the Apostles, chapter number 3, which was read in your hearing. Amen. And I just want, if you could, just drop down to verse number 6, which I think was the last verse that was read in your hearing. But Peter said, I do not possess silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I like this, walk, exclamation point. King James says, rise up, but the New Revised Standard Version says, walk. I want to talk this morning from the subject, I give you Jesus. I give you Jesus. Beloved, the backdrop of the Acts of the Apostles is a transition of these disciples, some 150 who had walked with Jesus. The core of that membership were those 12, now 11, but were replaced in Acts chapter 1, the replacement of Judas. These disciples had walked with Jesus, they had talked with Jesus, they had learned from Jesus, they had observed the ministry that Jesus came to initiate into the world. Their faith was challenged, Their experiences were problematic at times, but through it all, they grew. They had their stormy sea experiences, and they had those times of miraculous movement where Jesus used them to take a few fish and a couple of loaves of bread to feed the multitudes. They saw the blind receive their sight, the lame legs get strength. They even saw the dead get out the grave. But now the onus of this new ministry, this fledgling ministry, is falling on them. It had come to its fullest existence on the day of Pentecost, just one chapter over, but realistically some days ago, when they were in the upper room in one place on one accord with one purpose, and they were, as promised by Jesus, endowed with power from on high. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the ability to do so. And they came out of that upper room and proclaimed to the multitudes who had gathered in Jerusalem from every country the good news, or the gospel of Jesus Christ. After the crowd settled, these Jews, who had yet now begin to practice another religion called Christianity, did not abandon the religion of their childhood. They continued, just like Jesus when he was here, to go up to the temple at the time of prayer. They continued to observe all of the Jewish feasts and customs. And because they were growing in their faith, they too continued these practices. Chapter 3 begins that on the day that they were scheduled to go to the temple at the proper time, Peter and John went up to the temple to pray. As they were going to the temple, they were confronted at the temple by a usual sight. It was the sight of a beggar. A beggar who was lame from his mother's womb had been carried along and laid at the temple gate each day. I need you to notice, first of all, in the text that it says this was a man, meaning that he was no longer a child. He had been lame all his life, and now he had grown up and became a full-grown man. And for some reason, or for some case, maybe because of a lack of faith in medical technology and even healing, this man had relegated himself to being a beggar to gain some type of income. He enlisted people, maybe it was family, maybe it was close friends, that took on the task of bringing him to church. Bringing him to church every day and laying him at the gate, which is called Beautiful. How ironic, Sister Jillian, that he who was a lame man, who was lame from his birth, would be brought to church, not to be introduced to Jesus, but be brought to church so that he might beg of those who were going in to the church. Don't know when he started being brought to the church, but obviously this was a normal occurrence, because as we read down through the verses, everybody was familiar with this lame beggar at the gate. And although over the years they may have given him a couple of coins to help ease the stress of his lameness, nobody offered him healing. Nobody offered him an alternative to his situation. I mean, let's be real about it. Nobody offered him Jesus. Those who had been exposed to Jesus and the miracles that Jesus was able to perform, one might even ask the question through all of these New Testament scriptures, where was he when Jesus came to the temple? Was he there when Jesus frequented the temple during his 3 years of earthly ministry? How did Jesus overlook this man? Maybe Jesus came in at one of the other gates and missed him altogether. Or maybe his assignment, Sister Green, and his appointment at this gate, which the gate is called Beautiful, was his assignment, and his time for blessing was not then, but now. How many times have we made our way to the church, passing beggars, passing individuals who were seeking us, asking of us, desiring of us to do something for them while we were trying to get to the church to get something for ourselves? Peter and John was on their way to church to pray, to have communication and connection with God, and their trip is interrupted by this lame man who is laying at the gate. Why didn't anybody, Deacon Cornigans, invite him into the church? I mean, he's laying right there. They have to pass him. And they've passed him for many years and many days. They've seen him. They know his condition. They know him. But yet, they leave him outside. Well, if I could, let me provide an answer. See, in those days, illnesses were believed to be the result of sin. And sin made you unworthy, unholy. And so, because of that, you could not enter into the temple. Because with this illness, this ailment, you would defile the temple. And so they passed right by him. I like the New Testament church. I like the New Testament church of Jesus Christ, because the New Testament church of Jesus Christ welcomes the sick, welcome the afflicted, welcome the hurt, welcome the disease, welcome the maimed, welcomes the deaf and the dumb. It does not relegate us to the exterior portions of the church, but allows us and welcomes us in to the altar of God, where we might receive a good word and possibly healing. Wow. Just steps from the place of healing. Just steps from the powerful word of God that could have liberated this man from his physical ailment. That close, but not close enough. Somebody said 99 and a half just won't do. He was at 99 and a half. He was at the church. Interestingly enough, the people who brought him and laid him left him and went on in, only to retrieve him on their way back out. They came back out with a good word. They came back out with a renewed spirit, picked him up in his same condition, in his same circumstance, took him home, dropped him off, and the next day did the same thing all back over again. How many times do we pass people who are in physical need, mental need, or emotional need? But this is not just a physical need story. This is also a spiritual need story. Because when we read this text, it's about what Peter and John gave to this man. We already know that they didn't have silver or gold, because Jesus had already instructed them that when they go out to do ministry, take nothing for their journey. Don't take an extra coat, an overcoat, an umbrella, an extra sandwich. Don't take nothing for your journey, because God will provide people who will take care of you. And when Peter and John gets there and the man looks at them begging, expecting to receive, Peter says to him, first of all, check us out. Take a look at us. I mean, we didn't drive up in a nice chariot. We didn't have a chauffeur. Hello, somebody. We're not dressed in fine clothes. We don't have the fresh tunics of the day. No, we have raggedy clothes because we've been in the wilderness with Jesus for the last 3 years. We have raggedy clothes that might be a little musty because we were stuck in a room waiting for the promise of the Holy Ghost. And when it came, we began to speak in tongues. We got all excited and we ran out into the street. We haven't had time to change clothes. Look at us. Our outward appearance. But also, look at us. We're ex-fishermen. We're ex-common folk who are taking up a life of doing the ministry of Jesus Christ. We have nothing physical to offer you. Look at us. We're not physicians. We don't have some miracle pill that we could give you, some electrifying elixir that would give you the strength and power to get up. No, we don't have those things. The truth of the matter is told, as a Sunday school was grappling today with the parables of Jesus and how we can use modern day parables to meet the needs of the people that we're confronted with. These disciples were confronted with a need of the day, sickness, ailments. They could not call on Dr. Jesus because he was not there. They could not grab his hand and say, Jesus, what do we do at this point? They could probably reflect in their minds on how Jesus handled the other situations where he commanded them, the lame folk, to activate the faith that was on the inside of them and cause them to get up. For these brief few moments, I believe that Peter and John was going through all of the scenarios in their minds of what they had experienced. And they concluded that we don't have silver and gold. We don't have medical technology. We don't have miracle pills or miracle medicines to help you. But we're going to give you what we do have. I wish I had some help in here. See, it's really not about us giving folks stuff that we don't have. It's not about reaching in our pockets and getting out a couple of dust bunnies and handing it to somebody, telling them this is all that I have. No, it's about what we have been exposed to. That we have been with Jesus. That we have the testimony that Jesus has healed us. That we have the testimony that we were once lost, but now we are found blind, but now we see. See, we're not here to give people some prescripted message about somebody else's experience. We're here to tell folk about the Jesus that we know. Who is the Jesus that you know? See, I'm not questioning the personage of Jesus because we all know Jesus. But what is different about the Jesus that we know is the way that we came to know him. Hello, somebody. Some of us, like Paul, met him on the road to Damascus. Others of us met him maybe in the cemetery when we were out of our minds. Hello, somebody. Maybe we were hungry and he came along and gave us some bread. Maybe we were thirsty and he came along and gave us something to drink. Like that woman at Abraham's well, Jesus told her, if you drink of this water, you're going to thirst again. But I'll give you water that you'll never thirst again. See, we all know the healer, the provider, the protector, the savior, Jesus. But we didn't all come the same way to come to know him. It is that individualized role and exposure to Jesus that customizes our individual sermon that we preach each and every day of our lives. See, these disciples had been exposed to Jesus. They had seen Jesus, and exposure will breed transformation. Let me say it again. Exposure will breed transformation. If you spend time with something long enough, you'll begin to imitate it. You spend time with something and someone long enough, they will grow on you. Oh, come on, you've got some outfits in your closet that when you bought them, you were suspect. And then after second or third wear and everybody said it looked so good, you will not part from it for all the money in the world. Like Brussels sprouts and asparagus at first, you didn't want to have anything to do with them. And maybe some of you still don't want to have anything to do with them. But those of us who tried them because we had to, didn't have no options, we've come to love something that we didn't even know we could love. All of us have come to know Jesus in different aspects of our lives and our journeys. And the interesting point about it is that Jesus met us right where we were. I like the fact that in the Sunday school lesson, they were talking about the parables. And I need you to understand that although there were different parables that Jesus used, the message of Jesus was the same. It was the gospel, just spoken in different languages to different people. See, Jesus individualized the good news so the folk that he was talking to at the time could understand. When he was talking to the vine dressers, he spoke their language. When he was talking to the farmers, he spoke their language. When he was speaking to those who raised and cared for the cattle, he spoke their language, and they understood. See, even before Acts chapter 2, Jesus had already demonstrated the power of speaking in tongues. Somebody will get that one later on. The real responsibility of the church today is to learn how to speak in tongues. How to speak the language of the people that we are ministering to at the moment and understand the journey that has brought them to our doorstep. See, the problem with the traditional church at the time was that the traditional Jewish church was a closed church. And if you wasn't already in, if you didn't already meet certain prescribed parameters, you couldn't get in. There were a time in our lives that because of our color, we couldn't get in the church. We had to have our own service down in the lower quarter of the plantation. We had to have our service after all of the weekly work was done. And Master gave us a few moments so that we could dust off our shoes, polish our shoes, and put on our best clothes and go to the biggest tent or shack on the plantation. And if we couldn't find that, we gathered around the fire and we began to sing the songs of the faith. Beloved, we haven't always been welcome in the house, but I'm so glad. I'm so glad that the Church of Jesus Christ is an open door church. It's interesting that as we read through the book of Acts, and we'll get through Acts and Romans over throughout this summer, that when Paul, who was the Jew, went to speak to his brethren, the Jewish fellows, he was in the church. And at that time, even though the door was closed, it was an open air church. And Paul was preaching the good news of the gospel, and they ran him out of the church. And the Gentiles who couldn't come in the church, was on the outside of the church, heard Paul preaching, and they said, "We like what you're preaching, Paul. Come on and give it to us." And Jesus says, to many who would reject him, just as many he has given them the power to receive the word of God. And although Jesus has opened the doors of the church, and we symbolically do it every Sunday when we extend the invitation, there's still some closed doors. There's still some closed edifices that would not allow folk with tattoos and piercings, folk that don't look like us, act like us, walk like us, or talk like us, not have access to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Preach, Pastor Clark. I'm doing the best I can this morning. The Church of Jesus Christ is not a segregative gospel. It is an inclusive gospel because it understands that every single one of us are sinners. It recognizes the fact that all of us, according to Romans, have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Maybe you made your way into the building. I need to let you know you're still a sinner. And just because you're in the building doesn't make you any better than someone who's outside of the building. The gospel helps those who are inside and those who are outside. As we live in a world where gender is being questioned. Sexuality has taken on so many different labels. I'm so glad that the whosoever will of John 3:16 is still an invitation to everyone. I'm so glad that the whosoever will of John 3:16, regardless of your he, she, it, they status, you can come and receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Before we got to a point where we have to be politically correct, Jesus was already politically correct when he came to suffer and to die for all humanity, regardless of our race, creed, religion, ethnic background, or whether we live on the right side or the left side of the river or the train tracks. This time of transition for the disciples, as they come out as apostles, they are commanded to go ye therefore into all of the earth. Go into Jerusalem, go into Judea, go down there to the Samaritans, the folk that you don't even like, and preach the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth. I need to let you know that it's not your gospel. It's not the gospel that you determine who should receive it. It's your responsibility to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ to whomever you come in contact with. It's your responsibility, whether it's in the church, outside the church, down the street, outside of your apartment, outside of your house, in your community, in your neighborhood, at your job, anyone you come in contact with, it is your obligatory responsibility to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. All of these people saw this man in his condition, knew that he had been in that condition a long time, and they sidestepped him. They went right on by, went into the church, got what they needed, came by, and guess what? Stepped right around him and kept on going. And then the next day, saw him again, over and over again. We are confronted with people who do not have access to the grace and mercy of Jesus Christ, and they are restricted to that grace and mercy by those of us who experience the privilege of having that grace and mercy each and every day. Why is it, Sister Green, that we experience the blessings of heaven, but we don't want to share it with anyone else? Blessed people ought to bless others. Let me say it one more time. Blessed folk who have been with Jesus, who've experienced the unmerited favor of Jesus, ought to be overwhelmed, ought to be bubbling over with the responsibility and the opportunity to tell somebody about the unmerited favor of God extended to his only begotten son, Jesus Christ. But instead of doing that, we're so busy looking down our self-righteous nose that we exclude people from the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hopefully God won't exclude us from heaven at that last day, because I heard him say, when you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. My prayer and my hope is when we get to that day that we will hear him say, well done, and we will not hear him say, depart from me, I never knew you. Could it be that the knowledge of Jesus of us is dependent on how we exercise our faith on this side of heaven? Could it be the way that we treat the least, the lonely, the neglected, and the lost would be a determining factor on whether Jesus says to us, well done, or depart from me? I mean, think for a moment, all of the people who came up to the temple each and every day, sometimes three times a day, and passed this man and never extended him an opportunity to know Jesus. What would Jesus say to them? Peter and John have an experience such an ultimate, awesome interaction with the Holy Spirit, comes out of the upper room, skipping their way to the church, and they are confronted with the least, the lonely, the lost, and neglected. See, this lame man was just an example, because I believe he was probably not the only one that was laying out there at the various gates of the temple. But this is the one that is documented in this third chapter of the Acts of the Apostles. And when Peter sees him, let me pause right there. You need to open your eyes and see what's going on around you. You need to open your eyes and see what's happening in your community, outside your church, outside your home. Open your eyes. Be aware of what's going on and ask yourself this question: what can I do to make a change? When Peter sees this man, he fixes his eyes on him. In other words, they make eye contact. Thank you, Deacon Billings. I have to be transparent for a moment, Sister Green. You're driving down the street, you get to a corner, and you see that person. What do? Put your head down, look the other way. I mean, this is just jump. Pick up the phone. Yeah. Try to look busy like we're doing something, because we don't want to be confronted. We don't want to make eye contact, because if we make eye contact, because the eyes are the windows to the soul, we're going to see that person and we're going to be compelled to do something. The other day, I was driving through McDonald's. Franklin was in the back seat waiting for his French fries. As soon as I place the order and I pull out, there's a man standing there. My window is still down, and I'm turning. I can't avoid him. And he says to me, "Do you have a couple of dollars so I can get me a Big Mac meal?" And I said to him, I said, "All my spare change goes to my baby." And Franklin's in the back, and Franklin starts talking. Franklin starts talking to the man, and the man says to Franklin, "God bless you, little baby. I had to open up my hatch, reach down in there, and get a couple of spare dollars that I had down in the wild, because my son spoke to him." Doesn't the Bible say a child shall lead us? I was trying to avoid him, and Franklin talked to him, and because Franklin talked to him, the beggar blessed him. Oh, somebody gonna get this today. And because he blessed my son, I had to. I should have did it anyway. Because I had a couple of dollars right there in the glove compartment. But I didn't want to make contact. So y'all have to be transparent. I have to be real. Because life is real. Circumstances are real. And I realized after I was going to give him a couple of dollars, I actually gave him a five. As I drove away to pay the bill, Deacon Cornigans, I thought, only by the grace I heard you, Sister Green, when you said it depends on the situation. I couldn't respond because I had to tell the story. Situations will transform us. And it will move us. Why? Because we've been with Jesus. And I should have been the one blessing him. I should have been the one saying a prayer for him, but instead, he blessed my 20-month-old baby in the back of the car. He didn't understand what Franklin was saying, or did he? Because when they spoke in tongues, everybody heard the gospel in their language. The disciples didn't know the language that they were speaking, but the folk that heard them understood it was their language. Maybe, just maybe, just maybe, in that instant, Franklin was speaking the gospel because he's exposed to it each and every day, and the man heard it. Well, can I confess to you this morning that he wasn't the only one that heard the message? I heard it too. And I heard God say to me, you got some overflow. Pass it on. See, because every time I go through the McDonald's, they give me the change. I open up the hatch in the center console and I throw the change in and I close it. It's almost every other day that I go through McDonald's because Franklin got to have his French fries. It's his snack. He looks for it. And in the other morning, we were taking him from his sleep study, and we went through McDonald's, but it was breakfast. We got a hash brown instead of French fries. And the look on his face, he was so disappointed. He looked at the hash brown and he says, this is not my French fries. The point that I'm trying to make, I would put the change in the center console. It wasn't that I didn't have it. It was just there, and it's been piling up, and it was an opportunity for me to be a blessing. But I was so selfish in that moment that God had to convict me through my son. If we are going to be the church of Jesus Christ, we've got to be observant and we have to make eye contact. We've got to make a connection with those who do not know Jesus. And the moment that Peter looks at the man and the man looks at Peter, he gets expectation. He's going to bless me. He's going to bless me. He's going to give me what I'm begging for. He didn't say it. There was no dialogue that exchanged in that moment. He didn't say, how much you gonna give me? But Peter says, silver and gold have I none. Because I looked at you, because I made a connection with you, I know that's what you're expecting. But I don't want to disappoint you. That's not what I have for you. But what I do have. What I do have. What I do have. What do you have? What I do have. What do you have to offer the least, the lonely, the neglected? No, you may not have a room. No, you may not have an extra cheeseburger or a piece of chicken to give them, but you do have something. At least I hope. Through your testimony, through your songs, through the life that you live, you have Jesus. You've been exposed to Jesus. You have received Jesus as your Lord and Savior. It was Paul that says, I give unto you what I first received unto myself. You can't give it if you don't have it. And if you confess to have it, you ought to be able to give it away. Because the more you give it away, guess what? God's going to replace it. God's going to replace it. Pressed down, shaken together, and overflowing. The more that you give out of the abundance of your heart, ought to flow the love of Jesus Christ to any and to all. I don't have what you're expecting, but what I'm going to give you is going to be more than you expect. He says, silver and gold have I none, but what I do have, I give unto you. Now watch this. If you read the King James Version, you read the Revised Standard Version, it gives you a different illustration. King James says, he reached and grabbed him, and he lifted him up. And as he was lifting him up, his ankle bones that had never borne his weight, oh my God, up in here, when he lifted him up, strength came in his legs. Muscles that had been atrophied because of non-movement straightened out and began to obtain strength. And he stood up. King James gives us the process. The New Revised Standard Version says that he seized him by his right hand, raised him up, and immediately his feet and his ankles were strengthened. Watch this. He says, what I give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, watch this, walk. You can only do so much. Let me say it again. God has empowered you to do a certain amount to initiate the healing process in somebody else's life. Whether it's physical, emotional, spiritual, you can only do so much. Understand, Sister Green, your limitations. God is only going to do for you what you can't do for yourself. And once he does that, you're going to have to do the rest on your own. Listen, Peter said to him, silver and gold have I none, but what I do have, I'm going to give it to you. And he reached and he grabbed him by the arm and he lifted him up. That's all he did. That's all he did. Then God began to provide strength. Come on in here. God began to provide strength to the legs and the ankles. Then once God added the strength to his legs, then it reverted back to the man. Man, walk. Come on. Deacon Jones, can I argue this text right here for a moment? How you gonna tell me to do something that I ain't done all my life? How you gonna tell me to walk when I don't even know how to walk? I've seen other people walk, but I haven't been able to walk. And you gonna tell me to walk? I've had the blessed renewed experience of watching a child develop. I saw it, my other three kids, and now I'm able to see it in Franklin. And I watched that crawling, that pulling up, that standing up, those first couple of steps and then fall down to now where the boy just comes in here and just runs all around the sanctuary. It was a process that developed. This man had no process. And one of the reasons why Franklin wanted to walk was because everybody around him was walking. And as he looked at them walking and he looked at himself, he already knew he had feet, already knew he had legs. And he's probably asking himself, what are these things for? And now he's at the point where he has them and he's now standing up on them. And we didn't have to tell him. He just automatically did it. Watch this. It is inherent in your physical and your spiritual DNA, the ability to walk. It's inherent in your spiritual and your natural DNA to grow and develop. It's innate. You just don't get to a point where you stop learning. I mean, we get to a point where we stop desiring to learn because we think. But the ability to acquire knowledge and apply that knowledge goes with us to the day we take our last breath. And so when Peter says to the man, walk, he's literally saying, do what God designed you to do. So church, walk. Church, speak. Speak in the tongues of the day. Know the population. Know the children. I heard you Sunday school. How are we going to speak the language of our young people? Get to know the young people. Allow them to use their gifts and their talents in the church. It may not look like what it looked like when we were doing it. But they gave us an opportunity. Oh yes, Sister Green, Mother Reed, and others, it was confined to what we could do and how we could do it. But we could do it and we were in the building. They can't do it if they're not here. And we've got to make sure that our actions aren't running them away. We've got to ensure that our gossiping and our backbiting and our knife and rock throwing are not running the children away from the very institution that was designed to give them life, hope, and energy. It is here that Jesus Christ will save our young people. The same Jesus that saved us. The same Jesus that forgave and forgives us of our mess is the same Jesus that we are commanded to give to the least, the lonely, the neglected, and the lost. And the moment that Peter gives this man Jesus, he releases the faith of Jesus and God in this man. We don't know if he's Jew or Gentile. All we know is he is a creature of God. And the Bible says he's a man. But because of the innate ability to walk and to move and to be progressive, that once Peter speaks into his life and makes a physical connection with his hand, he tells him, walk. Activate the innate ability in you. And beloved, that's our role. Our role as a modern day church is to activate the faith in what seems to be a faithless generation. Our responsibility is to activate the innate spirituality that is in the children and adults today who are running from the church. Our responsibility is to open our doors, not just to the doors of the building, but the doors of our heart, that men, women, boys, and girls might see the Jesus that's on the inside of us. Get to know them, make a connection so that we can speak in tongues and speak their language, that they would hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, a gospel of inclusion and not exclusion. A gospel that reaches to the farthest points and lifts up those who are downtrodden. A gospel who plowed us up one day. A gospel that transformed our lives. A gospel that gave us place and opportunity. A gospel of a God who says, in spite of us, I still love you. A gospel that looks beyond all of our faults and their faults and see just what we need. A gospel that understands that we all need to be loved by somebody. A gospel that says, go ye therefore into the highways and the hedges and tell anybody, somebody, everybody about the gospel of Jesus Christ. I love the songwriter who says, I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can save anybody. The Jesus that we serve is able to save any and everybody. Just because they don't look like you, just because they may not smell like you want them to smell, just because they may not be dressed the way you want them to dress, gives you no reason or validation to exclude them from the gospel of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that when the man got up and began to walk, King James says he jumped up and he did what he hadn't been able to do all his life. Oh, I'm not talking about walk. Sister Green, he was able to go to church. I wish I had some help in here. He went in the church and he went up the center aisle leaping and jumping and shouting for joy. This is another sermon, but can I just say that the church has to watch how it reacts when folk get delivered. Because when he went into church, some of the folk who had passed him by began to question whether or not he was really lame. I wish y'all would read the book. I mean, is that the same one that was lame that they said he was lame from his birth? Look at him just jumping and leaping. I believe somebody went over there to try to sit him down. But when God has done something for you, when God has turned your life around, you're not worried about church politics. You ain't worried about no official board, no church board meeting. You want to give God some praise and tell God, thank you. I wish there was five folk in here that can jump up on your feet and say, he changed me. He transformed my life. He healed me. He delivered me. And no policy, no rule, no board is going to stop me from giving God all the praise. Can't give you the hymn number. Can't tell you what the morning prayer is. Can't tell you how to dress. Can't tell you how to act. But what I can give you is what I received for myself. One day I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shores, deeply, deeply stained within. But then the master of the sea, am I talking to anybody in here, heard my despairing cry. And from the waters, from the depths of the waters, he lifted me, and now safe am I. All I got to give you is what I know for myself, that God is able to pick you up, turn you around, plant your feet on solid ground. All I got to tell you that he's a heart fixer and a mind regulator. All I got to tell you, he's a wheel in the middle of a wheel. All I got to tell you, he's a lily of the valley and a bright and morning star. All I got to tell you, he'll be bread when you're hungry, water when you're thirsty. All I got to tell you, he's a healer, he's a deliverer, but most importantly, he's a savior. He's a savior. Anybody know that he's a savior? Don't fool me now. Did he save you? Did he grab you? Did he snatch you up one day on a hill far away? Stood an old rugged cross. It was the emblem of all suffering and all shame. My Bible tells me from the sixth to the ninth hour, he died. He died. Oh yes, Deacon Jones, he died for every sinner. He God. For every man, woman, boy, and girl, and everything in between. He died. He died and was buried. Preachers, help me. But early Sunday morning, he got up. He got up. All I got for you. All I got for you. I give you the name that is above every name. That name every knee must bow and every tongue must confess. His name is? I said his name is. His name is? I give you. Hallelujah! All glory! All glory! There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, oh. How I love, oh, how I love Jesus, oh, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me, oh, oh, how I love Jesus.
Tells me of
to me, God. Thank you. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. 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 What God has done for you. Go ahead and praise Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. Can't nobody do us like Jesus. Hallelujah. Can't nobody do us like the Lord. Thank you.
Father, on a personal level, I have noticed more and more people panhandling and begging when I'm getting off of the expressway. I saw an individual begging at Veterans Highway, another one at Old Nichols Road, another one down on Deer Park Avenue. Lord God, things are difficult. This virus has caused price inflation and size inflation, or sizeflation as they call it. People cannot make ends to meet. But Lord God, we know that you said you would supply all of our needs. You did not say you would supply all of our wants, but you said all of our needs. So Father, right now we just need you. Some of us are here to have our needs met. Some of us are here to receive salvation. Some of us just want a weekly fill up. Some of us are just here for routine and ritual. It is what is expected. But Lord God, we just need you to be God, to do your will, to help us to submit to your will, to surrender to your will, to yield to your way, to your word. Father, we need you to just deliver us, free us, employ us, remind us who we are and whose we are. Father, stir up the gift within us. We who are indwelt with your Holy Spirit, stir it up. Agitate your spirit within us so that we just have to yield and do according to your will. Some of us might not want to go and yield and surrender willingly. So Father, give us that push that we would do what is right and good in your sight. Father, people are grieving. We know that you know all things. Father, we pray for those people whose lives were lost in that submersible. Just be with them, be with their families, the friends, those who are grieving. The entire world was paying attention. So, Father, we just pray that the Spirit of God would be self-evident. However you are to get the glory out of this, Father, please do it and do it now. We pray for those who are victims of inclement weather. Hurricane season is upon us, and we pray for protection. We pray for those who are traveling and going on vacation. Give traveling mercy. Keep us safe as we come and as we go. Father, those that are bereaved, comfort, please. Touch us and move us that we might extend comfort, that we could give the warm embrace, that we could give the shoulder that would prop up and help and support. Father, again, we pray for the graduates and those that are moving up and moving on, those who are being elevated. Be with us. Be with them. Guide their steps. Order their steps in your word. Father, as it is the summer months, let us not take a vacation from you. Let us forever be in your presence. Let us, when we might forget to pray, when we might not read our scriptures as diligently, please forgive us of our sins. Stir up the desire that we would seek you bright early in the morning, that we might even seek you when it is still yet dark, but it's that quiet time. Father, provide quiet time so that we can not just pray to you, but hear from you. We need a word from the Lord. you have used your manservant to bring a good word, and he has given it. I pray that every heart would be, every heart would receive the message from on high. That we would not forget the orphan, the widow, the alien, those who do not know how to walk, those who may be confused about who they are and what they are to do. Just be with us, God. We love you. We need you. We repent of our sins, and we consider it done. You can do all things but fail. So, Lord, let us be victorious. Let us be more than conquerors. And let us endeavor to make eye contact and to help, to remember the marginalized, those who have been pushed to the edges. Let us be the bridge in the gap. Let us intercede. In Jesus' name, we thank you and we praise you. Amen, amen, amen. I am also tasked with the announcements. So I have this announcement, I believe you all do as well, from Sister Bull, but I will read it. Please grant me that. To my fellow laborers, I would like to go on record and register a great big thank you for your prayers, support, and generosity to the Baptist Training Union. Thank you for joining us on our annual Appreciation Day to Ocean Beach, Fire Island, and lunch at the Long Island Mentoring Center. The date is June 28th, I believe that is Wednesday. Meeting at First Baptist Church parking lot at 8:15. We will provide transportation to the ferry starting at 8:30 a.m. Our ferry will depart Bayshore at 10 a.m. We will be returning back to Bayshore on the 12:10 ferry. We will meet at the Long Island Mentoring Center for lunch, and we will be honoring members of our first BTU staff 50 years ago. We should give a hand clap right there. BTU, 50 years. God's grace is still amazing. You do not want to miss this historical moment in the history of First Baptist Church Baptist Training Union. Come and be blessed. This is a free day. You do not need a ticket, but you must register. I have a few seats left. Please see or call Sister Virginia Bull if you have not already placed your name on the list for Fire Island. This is our treat for your commitment to Christian education. It is essential for your growth. Virginia Bull. As Pastor had mentioned, the Pastor, Wendy Modeste, the transferring celebration is today. Bethel up the street has a new pastor. I just read to you the Fire Island information. I was told that the trip to Hershey, Pennsylvania has been canceled for lack of interest. The parking lot out here next Sunday will be torn up, so you will need to park in the parking lot at the school. I don't know how long that will be the case, but we will need to utilize the school parking lot.
Excuse me?
A few weeks. So, park across the street at the school in the school parking lot. And lastly, summer attire begins second Sunday. So we can come out of these robes and suit jackets and such, and we can get a little more comfortable. Now, that doesn't mean you can go and become scandalous. Amen. Okay. We can be casual and righteous, okay? Amen. God bless.
Let us prepare for our offering and benediction.
Just a reminder, after the offering, please return to your seats. The ushers will be marching. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you through our giving. We pray, dear God, that you would bless this offering. We ask that it be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth. We also ask, Lord, that you bless those who give and those who may not have it to give today. We ask always, Lord, that you would have your way. In Jesus' name, let us stand. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to make you stand without blemish in the presence of his glory with rejoicing, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time, and now and forever. Directions of the ushers.